Our session. I must apologize because there was one item which was the first item in which our Chief Minister from Bihar would have addressed you over a video conference. Unfortunately, that could not be brought about. So, instead of wasting much time, I'd ask Dr. Shoibal Gupta to begin with his introduction.
Friends, let me first welcome you all to this session on Bihar. This session will see presentation of five different authors. As an introduction, I only need to mention that Bihar, after stagnating for many years, has recently experienced a visible turnaround and provides an excellent case study for researching what the state as an institution can or cannot do for promoting development. Indeed, the part containing the presentation will be presided over by Professor Maitresh Ghatak, lead academic of IGC India-Bihar program. Thereafter, we have the final part, a roundtable discussion on Bihar, where panelists are expected to present their views on the changes that Bihar has experienced in recent years and the challenges that it may face in coming years. But the five studies that are to be presented in this session together seems to already outline the present mood of the state. Those of us who are familiar with the pattern of research on Bihar until a decade ago possibly know that, in contrast to the present scenario, most of the earlier studies were asking why the state is not on a development path in spite of its rich resource base. Some of these studies had tried to analyze the external factors that had inhibited the growth process in Bihar, while others focused on internal deficiencies of the state. Although many of these studies have been useful, they all had left a rather negative impression on the state of Bihar, that nothing really happens here. The five studies that are being presented here, however, are a complete contrast to this. They are all interested in analyzing some recent phenomena indicative of the transition of the state from a hopeless to a hopeful situation, where some innovative and new policies are being adopted. Mind you, the themes of these studies were chosen by the scholars themselves, not by the IGC, which had provided only some very broad guidelines for a choice of their research questions. Yet they all ask how things are now working in Bihar, not why things are not working. Of the five studies, four studies are concerned with four specific programs: role of ICT in education, Chidashree Dasgupta; bicycle program for girls student, Nitish Prakash and Kartik Muralidharan; women reservation and health outcomes, Santosh Kumar and Nishit Prakash; and educational policies, Priyaranjan and Nishit Prakash. The fifth one is a report on development priorities of the state. Ashiani Rai, and hopefully will be guide to various studies that government will be interested in being taken up. As you know, IGC program is demand driven. In other words, research issues under this program are primarily identified by the policymakers, generally the senior development functionaries. The program in its country strategy note had decided to work on two areas, economic transformation and resource mobilization. Studies commissioned are divided into these areas. Listing of all studies taken up is also available for reference. After this session and tea break, we have the roundtable discussion on development issues in Bihar. The discussion will be chaired by Professor Robin Burgess, the Academic Director of IGC. Apart from two senior members of State Cabinet, Mr. Sushil Kumar Modi, the Honorable Deputy Chief Minister and Finance Minister of Bihar, Mr. P.K. Shahi, the Honorable Education Minister. The discussions in this session will include senior policy advisors, N.K. Singh, Dr. Pranav Sen, Arunish Shawla, and Ranjit Kunhani. For a wider view of the development challenges in Bihar, we had invited few more senior development functionaries, but they could not join us as the simultaneous absence of so many senior officials from Patna would have left void in the state administration, which was not acceptable this month of September when danger of flood is always present. We also have this round table, two senior journalists, each of whom has been writing extensively on Bihar. They are Mr. Haribans and Mrs. Aditi Phadnis. From them, we also hope to hear some interesting comments. Thank you.
Thanks, Shoibal, for these introductory remarks. I'm Moitrish Kotak. I'm the lead economist of this IGC Bihar program. I also will be chairing this session. We have five presentations, and I'll be sort of they will be sequential. And then we have the discussants who will again sequentially speak. We have sort of a limited amount of time, so time management will be key. And I'll have the unpleasant task of sort of interrupting if I feel like the schedule is sort of not quite under control. But of course, we want to hear from the speakers and the discussants. That's why we are here. So we would obviously looking forward to a very interesting and exciting sort of set of issues and topics. So without further ado, I would like to get going. I should mention that at 3:25, we'll stop for a break. And also, this is for all participants. At 8:30, there's a reception at the sort of, you know, downstairs, and followed by dinner, and you're all welcome to that. So I would like to sort of get this session going by requesting Chiruśrī Dasgupta to present her paper, Role of ICT in Improving the Quality of Elementary School Education in Bihar.
Good afternoon, everyone. The interest in this work on the role of ICT in improving the quality of school education in Bihar started with an award being given to the Bihar government last year in 2010 by an NGO called Manthan. It's a South Asia award for e-education. And this was given specifically to the Bihar government's e-Samarth program, which is a computer-aided learning program, which is operational in middle schools, in 619 middle schools in Bihar, and covers 175,000 students and 2,100 teachers. This is the start of this program almost coincided with a huge literature that has spawned both nationally and internationally on the use of ICT for pedagogy, which has set out to identify the specific conditions under which effective learning interventions can be designed based on different kinds of use of ICTs. And most of this research has been trying to identify these conditions. And of course, the literature is contested, and there are two broad kind of views. The first is that technology-assisted learning is often seen as a tool to mitigate weakness in teaching methods or weakness in teaching and learning systems. And thus, it's kind of considered a substitute for actual teaching. However, there are other views as well, which puts forward that teachers are the agents of change in any kind of system of pedagogy. And so if indeed ICTs are to be used, it's teachers who have to be the agents of change. So this is the debate within which we've tried to frame our work. And in this, the second, so first is, what is it really? Is it that technology substitutes the role of teachers? Or is it that technology would be only a tool to which can be really made effective by teachers? The second question, which has been even more contested, has been that of what kind of delivery models would be best in delivering effective learning solutions through ICT. Now, in this, once again, the literature is very contested, and the literature, a lot of it is concentrated around different states of India, in which we've picked two specific states, Karnataka and Kerala, because both have experimented with multiple delivery models, and both have admitted failure of the public-private partnerships. And then they moved in different directions. Karnataka has relied more on outsourcing to NGOs, while Kerala has moved to a universalized public delivery system. And now, in all of these, there are three things which have really been fundamental. And here we find, once again, when we look at the literature and the experience internationally, there are two significant studies, one from Israel and one from the UK, where we find that the focus is specifically on teachers, the focus on computer and ICT-aided learning and not computer literacy. This is the second distinction that has been made in the literature. The third is focus on systemic improvements and not specific subjects or interventions. And the fourth is the contested domain of public ownership of knowledge resources. Now, it has been argued that these are the four things which determine the effective improvements in learning, or what's called learning effectiveness. So a mix of three different approaches have been used to look at the first debate is within, now the next debate is within economists, which is, as usual, debates about measurement, which is how do you measure improvements in quality of learning. So there have been a mix of three kinds of variables which have normally been used. These are behavioral, cognitive, and technical. And these have been used to design indices of quality of learning, which are, for example, used to monitor the Millennium Learning Goals. There is an initiative called EDPOL, which is also a DFID-funded research program consortium, which focuses on implementing quality education in low-income countries. And the main emphasis on all of these monitoring systems have been to just focus on cognitive learning outcomes, for example, tests. Now, while this debate has led to a formulation of a technical framework which combines quantitative and qualitative parameters, but these often tend to be one-size-fits-all tests at a point of time. And for example, there are these annual status of education report published by Pratham, which is a very big NGO in India, which has been working on these issues for a long time now. Now, both these approaches have limitation, and a combination of the two have often been suggested as the way forward. But even when you combine these two, the relationship between learning outcomes and socioeconomic status of individuals, implications of the relationship between learning outcomes and economic wealth, and the links between learning outcomes and the process of learning itself, that is, links between the process of delivery and the learning outcomes in a specific social context, often has not been covered. Now, this process-centric debate has been going on for 30 years. The earliest paper dates back to 1976, and the latest to 2010-11. However, there have been certain moves, for example, through UNESCO, where this the SACMIC surveys, which has been a huge survey of 42,000 primary schools, of both teachers and pupils in sub-Saharan Africa, is one of the largest on quality of education done so far. And it shows that program effectiveness in improving the four areas are highly contingent on pupil background, school context, school process, and so process has to be studied at multiple delivery levels. So keeping all of this in mind, we have designed a learning effectiveness survey to study the computer-aided learning program in Bihar, in which we've tried to define the learning goals within the program, what did the program intend to do. We've designed variables which cover all of these parameters that I just mentioned, which are knowledge, skills, and attitude. So it's a mix of cognitive and behavioral variables. And we also look at process, which is a mix of the technical and the social. And in this, we've carried out a survey, which is not very big, but big enough, of 5 districts, 25 schools. And we've tried to cover the 3 different kinds of delivery models that the Bihar government is currently pursuing. The first is a public delivery model, which the government itself says has not been very successful. The second is a PPP, a public-private partnership, but based on what's called build, operate, own, and transfer, where NGOs build and operate, and then they're supposed to transfer back to the government. And the third is also an initiative under PPP, but outsourced to an implementing agency, which is a private corporate.
Should I say just a few more minutes?
Yeah. Okay. So just to flag, I would just draw your attention to a few preliminary results that we have here. And the first one is that the government really wanted to know, identify the hard spots. And what we find is that 82% of our sample have a hard spot in one subject. But what I would like to draw your attention to is this slide, which is that there are 3 subjects, English, Sanskrit, and Maths, in which in English, 26% of our sample have difficulty in English, 52% are struggling with Sanskrit, and only 10% with Maths. But the percentage of students having difficulty only in English, Sanskrit, or Maths For example, percentage of students having difficulty in only in English is 75% of these 26% who have difficulty in English. Now, it's the last two columns that I would like to draw your attention to, which is flagged in red. That please notice the gender gap between in English and maths, which is for English it is almost 20%, and for maths it is almost 30% within the cohorts of people who do have difficulty in these subjects. Now the second is, what has e-Samat really done in addressing hard spots? And here there are perception gaps on the role of e-Samat. So we've listed the response of school authorities, teachers, and we've done a performance analysis based on exam scores. And once again, you can see there's a huge perception gap between school authorities and teachers on various measures of successful intervention, positive intervention. So for example, improved examination performance is the one that I would like to draw your attention to, where 64% of the school authorities felt that it's been effective, while only 44% of teachers felt that this has been effective. However, we couldn't find any significant correlation between the performance and the intervention in CAL, but that is something that we've got to look at more. But there are a few other indicators. For example, this is the status of trained teachers in e-Samat. You can see that they've been given between 15 to 126 hours of training. And the bulk of the teachers have been just given 36 hours of training under computer-aided learning. And then if you look at right down here, 57% of these teachers are not using the computer-aided learning tools in the classroom. Now, this is the last results that I would like to show, which is that in 2009-10, before the introduction of CAL, this is just from one school, we're going to analyze all the schools and then a pooled data set as well. But for the time being, what you can notice is that this is the marks obtained in English, and you can see that we've got this uniform M-shaped curves, the shift of the distribution. And of course, this is not a very simple thing to interpret, because one interpretation could be that on the whole, you can see that there is an improvement, because if you look at the cohorts which were scoring between less than 35 and 51 to 65 are coming down, while the scores 66 to 80 and above, the percentage of students falling under that cohort is rising. However, there are qualifications here in the sense that this is across, it's two grades. In 2009-10, these students were in class 6, and then they had intervention, the CAL was introduced in class 6. They studied with the help of CAL, but they're now in class 7. It's a different syllabi, different set of teachers. And so it's not easy to map this one-to-one. But of course, we do have a significant difference in performance here. Of course, another interpretation that can come is that the people who are doing well are doing better, but the people who are not doing well anyway are not really benefiting from CAL. This is the performance, and this interpretation finds support in our perception findings, where only 30% of students have said that they actually feel that they benefit from CAL, and these have turned out to be students who are the top 20 to 30% of the class.
Thank you. Thank you very much for that. The next speaker is going to be Priya Ranjan, and he's going to present on education policies and practices.
Can I just push the arrows?
Yeah, of course.
Thank you.
Yeah, so this is going to be a survey on education policies, and this is joint work with Nishit. So what we intend to do in the paper is the following. So survey the literature on the effectiveness of education policies adopted in different parts of the world on both quantity and quality dimensions. So we're going to look at policies which have helped improve quantity of education, which is basically getting more kids in school and increasing enrollment, and then quality, which is how much they're learning in school, how they're doing on test scores and so on. And we're also going to look at some policies adopted by the government of Bihar towards this goal, and we aim to put these policies appropriately in our broader survey framework to make this a contextual survey. And ultimately the goal would be to identify some best practices in education policies and possibly make some recommendations for Bihar. So that's what we intend to do. But what we have done so far is kind of the first step, which is to look at the status of education in Bihar. So I'm going to show you several pictures today, looking at the status of education, both on quality and quantity dimensions. So we're going to start with some quantitative measures, and we're going to use data from two sources, ASER, which as Chirashri mentioned is done by Pratham, an NGO, and they have some measures on quantity and quality. And then we're going to use data from DICE, which collects district level information on education. So the graph that I'm going to show you will have four lines. Each graph will have four lines. There'll be two dashed lines, one on the top and one at the bottom. And the top will be the best performer in India, best state, and the bottom will be the worst state. The red line is going to be for Bihar, and a solid black line will be for the median state, so the state in the middle. So if Bihar's line is above the median, that means Bihar is doing better than half the states in India. And if Bihar's line is below the median, then Bihar is going to do worse. And these are numbers, so in some cases you have to interpret it slightly differently, but I'll walk you through these pictures. So here is the first one. This is a number on out-of-school children. So what percentage of children, elementary school age children, are out of school? So this is from ASER. And so we have it by gender. And you can see that here Bihar is above median, but that's bad because you want this number to be as low as possible. Ideally, you want this number to be zero. So the best performing state is here, and this is the median. So Bihar is slightly above median, even though it's converging. This line is going down, that means Bihar is doing well over time, so but still it's above the median. So Bihar, in some sense, according to this, is doing worse than half the states in India as far as number of out-of-school children is concerned. And this is a slightly disaggregated picture where you see it for different age groups. And again, the pattern is roughly similar. That is, Bihar's line is above the median for all age groups. However, it's coming down in all age groups. In absolute terms, the numbers here are pretty high. Older children are more likely to be out of school than younger children. And we're going to see the same thing using DICE data as well. And there's convergence towards median for all age groups. So from DICE, we have data on enrollment ratios for all states, and starting in 2003 and 2004. So these are numbers for gross enrollment ratios. So here, the higher the number, the better you are doing. So Bihar was below the median till 2006 and 7, and since then it has moved above the median. And you can see that the rate is very close to 100%, or gross, in fact, has gone above 100%. So that suggests that there's near universal primary enrollment in Bihar. You get a pretty similar picture from net enrollment. Unfortunately, DICE does not report net enrollment beyond 2006 and 7. That's why the red line stops there. But it converged to almost the best performer in India. So Bihar is roughly the best performer as far as net enrollment ratio is concerned at the primary level. However, when you look at upper primary, which is the higher part of elementary education, I guess 7th, 8th grades, there Bihar is not doing as well. It's doing pretty well in primary education, but in upper primary, in fact, you cannot see the red line here because the red line basically overlaps completely with the bottom. So that means in terms of gross enrollment ratio for upper primary grades, Bihar is right at the bottom. You get a very similar picture from net enrollment as well. So we are doing slightly better. The trend is upwards in net enrollment at upper primary level, but still it's in the latest year it was about 48% net was slightly less. Gross was about 50%. So net enrollment in upper primary education was quite low. So this is low both in absolute terms and in relative terms, relative to other states in India. So here is a summary of our evidence on quantity of education. So out of school rate is higher than the median but declining over time. Enrollment ratio at primary level above median, almost universal primary enrollment, and at upper primary level still very low, right at the bottom in India. Now we're going to look at some measures of quality of education, and we've taken two numbers from our data. One is whether children can read a long paragraph, so this is a test of reading ability, and whether they can solve a simple division problem. So this reading test is basically based on one paragraph taken from a class 2 textbook. So whether a child can read one paragraph from a class 2 textbook or not. And the division problem is single digit division, like dividing 9 by 3 or something like that, whether they can do that or not. So Bihar is close to the median as far as reading is concerned. It was slightly below the median, but it has converged to the median, so it's doing as well as half the states in India. This is a picture disaggregated by class, so for different classes. In fact, in this you see that Bihar is slightly above the median in all classes. However, in absolute terms, I mean, even though in relative terms Bihar is doing fine, in absolute terms these numbers are not very flattering. Because to give you just one example, about 30% of children in the sixth grade cannot read a paragraph from a second grade textbook. So in absolute terms, there's a lot of scope for improvement, even though in relative terms they are doing well. I have just 2 minutes left, so I'm going to rush through this. In math also, you see a similar pattern. That is, Bihar is around the median in aggregate terms, but it's doing better than the median for all classes. However, in absolute terms, about 50% of fifth graders are not able to do a simple division problem. So in absolute terms, the picture is not very good, and there's still a lot of scope for improvement. So this is a evidence summary of evidence on quality. I think I've talked about it already and I'm running out of time, so I'll just show you one more slide, which is evidence on schooling input. So these were performance indicators. There's a lot of data on different schooling inputs. I've listed some of them. So we have numbers on all these, and we've plotted them, and this also shows you where you can possibly intervene. We do want to correlate these two performance measures later. But here is a brief summary of evidence on schooling input. So as far as the student-teacher ratio is concerned, Bihar is right at the bottom among Indian states, not doing very well. So there's a lot of scope for improvement on this dimension. And this could also be related to low numbers of enrollment in upper primary. Maybe there aren't enough teachers in schools, so children are not showing up to schools. Number of teachers per school is very low as well, right at the bottom. And some of these other measures, percentage of schools with toilets, which turns out to be a significant predictor of school enrollment and quality in other studies. Bihar is below the median. Surprisingly, percentage of schools with a drinking water facility, which used to be above the median, has gone down slightly below the median. So these are numbers for primary schools, and we get a similar picture for upper primary school as well. So I had all these pictures, but there's no time to show them. So this is the overall summary. So Bihar has made substantial progress on the quantity front at the primary level, but at upper primary level, enrollment is still very low. In reading and math, Bihar is doing fine in relative terms, doing better than most states in India, but in absolute terms, there's a long way to go. And record on us, schooling input front is weak, both in relative and absolute terms. And maybe there's a lot of focus on enrollment at primary level and relative neglect of some of these other quality dimensions. So that's something to keep in mind. Hopefully we'll have more things to say in the Patna meeting in December. That's it.
Thanks a lot for that. And also thanks to keeping within the schedule. So the next speaker is going to be Shantosh Nishit Prakash. He's gonna talk about cycling to school.
So thanks for inviting me. The motivation for this project is very straightforward. I come from Bihar. And secondly, economic motivation. First of all, I have been quite intrigued and fascinated by different policies that has been undertaken by the Bihar government in the last 6 years. And one of the policy was the cycle scheme. And I always wanted to work on this project. And I'm very thankful to IGC for the support and to the Bihar government for letting us, especially Mr. Shaheen, who's sitting here. So increasing school attendance for girls is one of the Millennium Development Goals. So obviously this is important to all of us. Secondly, improving female education, why is it important? First, it directly contributes to the inclusive growth. First of all, if you raise the human capital, so this is going to have the impact, especially if you focus on the gender, because it has this impact on intergenerational. If the mother is more educated, it's going to positively impact the children and so on. And secondly, it has an impact in the labor force and also in the participation. Secondly, there has been a lot of studies on returns to education by Durai Swami, Agarwal, and Nita Kingdon. And they all talk about the high economic returns to education in India. And despite all these factors, we do find low school completion rates, we find high dropout, and we find a lot of students who are absent at school. So the question is, talking in context of Bihar, these are like some of the studies that has been very new studies, and they use national sample survey data and the India Human Development Service data. So they are representative nationally and also at the state level. So they talk about large gender gap in schooling in developing countries, especially related to enrollment, attendance, dropout, and attainment. And talking about rural versus urban Bihar, you can clearly see that currently 63% girls are enrolled against 81%. In the age category 10 to 14, so there is definitely a gap. And 27% girls to 40% in the age category 15 to 19. And this uses the national sample survey data. And similarly, for urban India, we find that there is a gap in terms of gender gap when it comes to schooling. Now, there has been some study that talks about low attendance and attainment among girls in Bihar. So, this is the maybe trying to motivate you why this policy is important and what can we learn from it. So the policy intervention was in 2006 when the new government came, and the idea was quite innovative to provide bicycles to girls of class 9th and 10th. And approximately this is 2,000 rupees, which has been increased to 2,500 rupees per girl student. And it was called Mukhyamantri Balika Cycle Yojana, and now it's called Mukhyamantri Cycle Yojana because it covers not just girls but also boys. And this is the key difference. I mean, the scheme, it was not that the scheme was unique to Bihar, other states have also implemented the scheme, but the universalization in terms of just giving to all girls was pretty unique to Bihar. And I think that's something that I wanted to make clear. Now the policy question is, does cycle scheme increases girl enrollment? And secondly, does it have any impact on learning outcomes? Now, what we are going to focus in this project, and hopefully I'll have results to present for the Patna conference in December, is first of all, does this policy reduces the gap in enrollment? And is it cross gender, caste, and religion? And secondly, learning outcomes. So we have been fortunate enough to get data on test scores, which is the Bihar board exam data. And we should be able to look into the share of students passing 10th grade and passing with first, second, third division and the distinction. And the motivation is, if you increase enrollment, I mean, this may lead to reducing of the mean score, but it might lead to increase in the absolute number of girls at the higher level of attainment. And we are actually quite interested in a possible follow-up survey, because when I visited few districts in Bihar, and after talking to the policymakers and the student, looks like it's not just enrollment and learning, but maybe it's more about female empowerment, like owning an asset. So we do want to explore a possible follow-up survey where use of the, because the idea is, if you have a bicycle and it's considered to be a sign of self-confidence, especially in the context of Bihar and also in India. Now, the approach that we take is, what we're trying to do here is, let's say we take a difference of enrollment in girls pre and post the program. Now, if we try to do that, what's going to happen? I mean, suppose there has been several policies that was targeted towards girls. And if we just take this difference, and we might say that, oh, the impact is, say, pretty big. But what if the impact was the same even without the policy intervention? So that's why what we do is we use the boys as a possible control, which takes care of the fact that there could be changes in income, maybe marriage market, maybe labor market, and the government policies that were specially targeted towards school-going children. So what we do is, like, we take a difference of boys, which is again pre and post, and I think if I'm not correct, this policy got implemented for boys in the current 2010-11 academic year. So, and we are using Jharkhand and Uttar Pradesh, especially the border district, to Bihar as a control or as a robustness check. So, map of Bihar, and we are potentially using like 6 districts of Uttar Pradesh and 9 districts from Jharkhand, and we are because for Jharkhand and Uttar Pradesh there has been a policy cycle scheme, but it was not universal. Now, trying to give you a picture like what we are trying to do here in terms of the strategy. So let's say this is pre-cycle and this is post-cycle. So this is the graph for, let's say, the girls' enrollment over time, and this is boys' enrollment over time. So if there has been a policy intervention, now let's say the girls' enrollment, there is a kink here, and what we don't observe is this line in reality. So we are using, that's why we are using the boys' difference to compare the actual impact of this policy. And this is the graph. I mean, this is 24 districts. The data has already come in, and for Bihar. So this is, the blue line is the enrollment of class 9 boys, and red is the enrollment girls for class 9. And what we actually see is a very nice kink around 2007, which you can see that the slope has is more positive, which is of course the good news. And this is for class 10, and this is in comparison to Jharkhand. So even though Jharkhand has a policy, we do see that there is something, but the policy was there ever since 2002-03. So what we do is we will be using Jharkhand as a control, and this is again comparing Bihar and Jharkhand enrollment. Now, this is for class 10, and what's the data work so far? We have data from 26 districts, and 2 are incomplete, and 9 districts from Jharkhand, 3 incomplete. and these are the district names in Bihar that have not sent the data, and these are the, and I think the possible reason is related to the flood. And we already have the examination board data from both Bihar and Jharkhand starting 2004 to 2010. And we are very grateful to IGC for supporting this project, and we are extremely grateful to the government of Bihar, especially Ministry of HRD, for letting us and helping us throughout in this process. Thank you.
Thanks a lot, Nishit. The next speaker is Shantosh Kumar, and he's going to talk about women's preservation in Bihar and children's health outcomes.
Thank you, everyone. So in this project, I'm going to talk about the impact of women's reservation in local governance in panchayat elections. Its impact on outcomes related to children's health and also women's health. This is a joint work with Nishit Prakash. So just to tell you that in this talk, I'm going to talk about the project, what we are going to do, and the empirical methodology. We do not have data, we haven't gone far to do any analysis, so I won't be showing you any result today. So if you look around, about 50% of the world's population are women, and their political participation is far below their parity. So that is not even close to 50% or 40%. That is way below than 50%, around 18.4% of parliamentarians worldwide, they are women. Whereas the percentage population of women is close to 50%. So there is a big gap between the political process between the male and female population. And there are many barriers to political participation of women, and it includes institutional barriers, cultural norms, also voter discrimination, in which voters may be biased towards male and they do not vote the female politicians into the elections. Another barriers could be the low education of women folks. In general, there is a big gender gap in education. So maybe voters, they are not willing to vote the low educated women in the political decision making. So to correct this under-representation of women, many countries have adopted electoral gender quotas. And these quotas could be gender quotas or also quotas for minority community, for example, for SC or ST in India, or could be based on religion as well. The other argument for this is that in many countries, from development perspective, there has been decentralization of governance, in which the governance has moved from the top, from the center to very local level. And it is argued that gender or minority reservation of political elected position is to improve targeting of developmental and welfare programs to women and vulnerable groups. So for example, in a similar study in West Bengal, women leaders, they had a preference towards drinking water facilities because they are the responsible for fetching water from far off areas. So in 1993, India introduced this quota-based political reservations in local elections, in local bodies of governance, and which was called 73rd Constitutional Amendment. But this was implemented in different states at different time period, and Bihar was late in implementing this policy. And one of the broad objectives of this policy was to promote gender equality in human development by making rural service provision and local governance inclusive and responsive to the needs of women. However, if you look at efficacy of these quotas, the objective is to improve the functioning of the governance, improve some of the outcomes which are very important for human capital developments. Whether such outcomes have improved over the years because of these political quotas or not, that is a big policy question. The pro argument for this is that such policies are needed to correct the gender inequalities which are pre-existing in the political process. And it's also good for targeting of developmental programs. And against argument for these kind of gender quotas are that these quotas are undemocratic and less effective leaders could be elected into the political process. There can also be elite capturing, in which the argument is that these women folks are low educated, so it's not the women who are the actual leaders, but it's the husband of these women or the more educated women in that locality or area, they are in, get into the process of political decision making. So there's a capturing of governance by the elite of that society. So that is against argument for these kind of quotas. However, if you look at the evidence so far, there is more evidence needed to truly evaluate the impact of such affirmative policies in India. So I'll just go through briefly about the, on the existing evidence on women reservation and its impact. The seminal paper on this policy was by Chattopadhyay and Duflo in 2004, done in West Bengal and Rajasthan, in which they found that women leaders are more likely to invest in drinking water facilities, because women folks, they care more about the drinking water. There was some other paper by Munsi and Rojengwise in 2008. They also report that investment made by the female leaders was not only concentrated to water-related goods, but also towards non-water-related goods. However, in a different paper by Burdhan, which was again done in West Bengal, he and his colleagues, they could not find any impact of female reservation on any of the public goods, either provision of public goods or the quality of public goods. Another paper by Beeman and Pandey and their colleagues, they analyzed the Millennium Survey data for around 10 to 12 different states in India, and they found that they found insignificant effect on the quality of public goods. So it's not very clear cut whether if when we reserve the political seats for women or for some minority, whether that is going to lead to a very improved outcomes in a scenario where maybe some other complementary factors could also be important to have a true benefit of these kind of policies. So in that context, the main research question of this project is to look at the impact of women reservation in panchayats in Bihar on health outcomes. So previous studies, they have mainly looked at the provision of public goods, whether in more investment in drinking water facilities have been done or not. But whether if we invest more in drinking water facilities, whether that has led to reduced waterborne disease or not, whether that has led to reduced diarrheal prevalence or not, that kind of outcomes have not been looked before. And in this project, we are trying to look at those outcomes, whether the reservation for women leaders have led to any improvement in those outcomes, health outcomes or not. So specifically, within Bihar, we want to compare districts which has more female leaders to districts which has fewer number of female leaders. And the problem with this evaluation is that this policy was implemented in all the districts of Bihar. So there is no control so that we can make a comparison. So it's not that we can compare district Patna to some other districts, because all the districts were under the program at the same time. So what we are doing in this project is that we are looking at Jharkhand districts as the control districts, and we want to compare the difference between Bihar districts and Jharkhand districts between the pre-policy period versus post-policy periods. So it's similar to a different kind of empirical framework where we are subtracting these two differences. Why Bihar? Because this policy has been evaluated in some other states as well. So the one motivation for doing the same stuff in Bihar is that there could be a problem with the external validity. So if the women reservation was effective in West Bengal, it may not be necessarily true that it can be effective in Bihar as well, because there are lots of heterogeneity, there's lots of difference in institutional mechanism. So we want to study whether such a policy in Bihar system can have the desired outcomes or not. Okay. So I'll talk about briefly about the outcome measures. So basically we are looking at the healthcare utilization, for example, antenatal care, children vaccination, and institutional delivery. So skilled birth delivery. These are the three outcomes we are trying to look at in this project. So this is the empirical strategy we want to employ in our study. So it's a double defense where the control is Jharkhand and treatment is Bihar. And we are using DLHS, which is district level household survey 2, which was done in pre-program period in 2001 and 2. And post-program period will be 2007 and 8, where DLHS 3 is used as a post-program data. So I'll just show you a few trends in healthcare, in health outcomes for Bihar. So this is a graph for ANC utilization between 2001 to 2008. One thing to notice here is that there is an increase in ANC utilization across time in most of the districts. For full immunization of children, the same story. For institutional deliveries, the same story. But what we want to do in this project is that whether this increase in these outcomes are due to women reservation or to what portion of this increase can be attributed to women reservation. Because so many things have changed at the same time in Bihar. New government has come up. The function of government has changed. There are some other central programs as well, like JSY, Janani Suraksha Yojana, which could have also led to increased institutional deliveries. So we want to do a causal methodology, and we want to find out that what portion of this increase in health outcomes over time can be attributed just to women reservation per se. So that's the main goal of this project. So in the future, we just want to establish the causal effect of this policy on health outcomes. And we also want to identify what are the factors that has led to heterogeneous impact of these policies. Why some districts have gone up by increased institutional delivery by 2%, some districts have increased institutional delivery by 10%. So what are district level covariates that are important for such a heterogeneous increase in health outcomes over the time periods? So these are two goals of the study, and probably later on we'll have some results to share with you. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Our last speaker.
Get started. So I think, having talked to a number of the people on this panel, to the very distinguished panel, we'd like to keep this reasonably interactive. So what I suggest we do is we perhaps begin with the Deputy Chief Minister. And the format I'd like to follow is to have each of the panelists restrict themselves to just 2 or 3 minutes. And I think the thing I'd like you to focus upon is to perhaps challenge us by saying, what is it we should be doing, which we're perhaps not doing. The example of industry in the previous session was an example of that. And then after that, we can have questions from the floor and have a kind of more of a discussion rather than just a simple presentation and then an ending of the session. So I think what I'll do is I'll just introduce each person and then hand the mic to them, and then they can say a few things, and then we can open up after about 15 minutes. So can I begin by...
Sorry to interject. Can I just, for the purpose of video, because this is all going on the LSE website.
Okay.
Are you all right? Are you all right?
Perfect. Thank you very much, gentlemen.
So can I...
The bottles are not obstructing you, I hope.
Bottles are cool.
Can I begin by asking Sushil Kumar Modi, the Deputy Chief Minister?
I would like to raise, there are seven, topic for this roundtable conference and roundtable discussion is Bihar transformation to a developed state by 2015, challenges ahead. In the previous session, many of the researchers, they have mentioned all the different challenges. But I am mentioning, as a deputy chief minister, I'm working this state for the last 7 years as a deputy chief minister. The biggest challenge is electricity. Though we are in power, but there is no power. So the power is the biggest challenge for this state. The next challenge is how to contain the floods. Because more than two-thirds part of Bihar are every 2 year, 3 year, they're inundated by the floods. So how to minimize the impact of floods? Number three is agriculture, because about more than 80% of the population is based on agriculture. And the holdings are very small. The more than 90% of the holdings are, the farmers are small and marginal farmers. So the third biggest challenge is how the small holdings can be viable to increase the income of our farmers. Number four, we are mentioning about the migration, the skill development. Because most of the migrants who are going outside Bihar, they are not skilled people. So they, though 8% of GDP may be from remittance, but the amount of remittance can be increased if the migrants are more skilled, they have more vocational training. Number five, the basic thing is implement. How to implement? So improving the delivery mechanism. So in a state like Bihar, the delivery mechanism is so poor that most of the benefits, they are not being able to be provided to the poor people. So how to improve the delivery mechanism? And the sixth, about which Mr. Prof. Sen was also mentioning, regarding the industrialization. They are going to have it making all its effort, but we want help of the central government, because no state government can prosper or can improve its financial conditions without the help of the central government. And so we were demanding that Bihar should be given a special category status. It means, because already there are 11 states in India which have been given special category states, it means if anybody wants to invest in a special category state, they will have advantage of income tax exemptions, excise exemptions, and many other advantages are because of that special category states. So I think these are the six major challenges. And if Bihar is able to overcome these six major challenges, and because there is, we don't have much time, I've only mentioned about these challenges, and Bihar government is making all its effort to meet the deadline to make Bihar developed state by 2015. And we have made all the detailed programs and regarding all these two things. So I've just mentioned all the six big challenges which Bihar need to be addressed. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Can I now turn to P.K. Shahi, who is the Minister for Human Resource Development.
Even though in 6.5 years of the Christian government rule, there has been paradigm shift in what Bihar was pre-2005 and what Bihar is in 2011. And yet, challenges are numerous. I'll be focusing particularly on the educational sector. You can imagine in primary sections, we have about 20 million children enrolled in the schools. The sheer magnitude of the figure will alone tell what kind of challenges we have, particularly when there is huge resource gap. The gap is in various fields, like we don't have trained teachers, boys are being taught by untrained teachers. We don't have facility to train teachers. Then we are short of school buildings. We are short of classrooms. Other areas also, some of the areas the young researchers have focused, like drinking water and common toilet and all that. So these are challenges, and we have limited resources. And on top of it, Government of India has enacted the right to free compulsory education in primary sections, which has created a huge liability I have not converted it in billion or in terms of rupee, it is roughly about 30,000 crores rupees. That is one time, and then we have recurring expenses. And the entire budget of education department is roughly about 12,000 crore only, which means we don't have even a small amount to be spared to implement the law enacted by Government of India, namely right to compulsory free education. However, despite all these constraints, government has been endeavoring in the last 6.5 years, there has been tremendous impact in improvement of education. We have, thus we have been able to succeed on quantity front. Now we have to focus improvement of quality in school education. Recently, in September itself, Government of Bihar, in association with UNICEF and some non-government organizations, we have been working to implement sustained and focused scheme of improvement of quality education. And in this month, we have launched that, which in, translated in English means understand and learn. That program is to continue up till 2015 with a hope that by that time it will have definite impact on improvement of quality education in schools, primary schools. Then we have gap in secondary schools as well. The students who will be passing out from primary will require secondary schools. We have huge gap in secondary school, number of secondary schools. We need to construct not less than 15,000 secondary schools in next 3 to 4 years. So all these challenges are there, and of course it may be difficult to meet those challenges given financial constraints. Nonetheless, we are trying, and we have been telling Government of India also that a state like Bihar, which has lagged behind for very many reasons in last couple of decades, needs special assistance, as has been pointed out by my Honorable Deputy Chief Minister, that the state of Bihar has been trying to persuade Government of India to accord special status so that some additional financial support is provided. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Could I now turn to the Principal Secretary of the Department of Commercial Taxes project?
I just have two suggestions rather than any comments. One is that maybe IGC or some of the researchers could do a study on the shift from the primary sector in Bihar towards the manufacturing and services sector. The figures that I see are that we have about less than 20% is contributed by the primary sector, and more than 60% is by the services sector, which is largely unorganized, and manufacturing sector in Bihar in any case is very low. So it may be interesting and useful to see what is the shift like and how does it compare with other states or the rest of the country. The second point was that as Deputy Chief Minister pointed out, the biggest challenge is energy. And in Bihar, while there are projects to harvest thermal energy, maybe what is the scope and what could we do to harness renewable energy in the state is something which again could be studied. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Can I turn to Pranav Sen, the Planning Commission?
Thank you. Let me begin with one of the issues that was raised by Mr. Modi, which was the issue of migration. And he talked about the remittances that are coming and the need to increase the per migrant remittance. But let me submit to you that in terms of a development strategy, I think Bihar also needs to take into account the fact that migration in the Bihar context does involve a huge amount of brain drain. And today I believe that the situation is ripe for Bihar to try and attract reverse migration of the very large number of very highly qualified Biharis who are outside the state. And I think they should take that as a challenge and ask the question, what would it take to get these people back? The second issue that I think one should consider is that when we think about development and development strategies, it is very different for a state which is part of a nation than the strategies that you would employ for a nation state. And that is because of the kind of control and authority that the government has on being able to retain the fruits of its developmental efforts. So the entire strategic approach to development for a single state has to be rethought, and rethought come out of the context of the usual growth strategies that we talk about. Finally, again, an issue that Mr. Modi had brought up is the issue of agriculture, which is a dominant part of the Bihar economy. Bihar is today perhaps the only state, maybe one of three or four states, where survival agriculture still is the dominant form. It's a risk minimizing kind of agriculture. It's farmers who are essentially producing to keep their families alive. The rest of the country has started to move towards more commercial. There's much greater risk taking with attendant problems, I admit. But unless Bihar actually moves to that kind of a pattern, it's not going to be easy to increase agricultural productivity. Now, in order to do that, in a context of, as we said, very, very small farms, 90% of Bihar farms are small and marginal holdings, the manner in which you do the sort of the change the risk perception of the farmers in that kind of a context, it will have to be thought through and it has to be researched. And this, I think, is one of the biggest challenges that Bihar faces, because unless Bihar agriculture changes its character, Bihar is not going to go very far.
Thank you very much. So why don't we turn to NK next. NK is a member of the Upper House of Parliament.
Thanks, Robin. I think I entirely agree with all the points which have been made by earlier interventions by Mr. Modi, by Mr. Shahi, and others. I think Mr. Modi has summed up some of the more critical challenges that Bihar has. I have 3 minutes to mention before you 8 challenges that I perceive, not necessarily concurrent, but from a different. First and foremost is that we must recognize that in the last 5 years, an 11.8% average rate of growth was achieved by Bihar, largely driven by the power of public outlays. So the first and foremost challenge is to create opportunities in which we are able to entice private capital for the next 5 years to be able to sustain the same rates of growth. Robin, you asked the question, what are some of the areas where research can be done? What can Bihar do to create an enabling environment which is able to attract private flows and generate public-private partnership in a manner which is acceptable? Number two, what can one do to further refine the various models on public-private partnership, particularly because you require variant models on infrastructure as compared to the model which you require for the social sector on public-private partnership? What are the gainful kinds of learning experience but which is sui generic to Bihar's conditions, and therefore different models of concessionary agreement for infrastructure and for the social sector. Third, what can Bihar do to use its political leverage as the center to have genuinely a bipartisan relationship between the center and the states in terms of devolution of resources to the states, in terms of central sector investment to states, and in terms of the allocation, for instance, of critical inputs like coal for enabling us to overcome the power handicap. Fourth, what can Bihar do considering the fact that in its demographic profile, we are much younger than the average demographic profile for the rest of India to do invest in vocational education, and because skill requirements are changing. I mean, Robin, if you look at this week's London Economist, it has a special section on what are the jobs of the future, because the demand for jobs are also changing. And a traditional method of looking at jobs is something which may prove not very effective. So how can we inculcate vocational skills, not only for value-added migration that Mr. Modi mentioned, but which is in consonance with the changing demand pattern in the future. Fifth, I think that on agriculture, certainly what Mr. Modi has mentioned is correct, because the fragmentation of land holdings and because yields have plateaued. But I think there is an additional challenge. The impact of global warming and climate change on Bihar's agriculture, because there are the huge uncertainties which are accompanying this, and the little global warming is leading to decline in the forms of wheat. So what kind of new agricultural patterns and new kinds of seeds which will withstand the uncertainties created and the challenges created by the global warming and climate change? Fifth, I think he mentioned floods. Floods, of course, have two dimensions. One is how can optimize the inter-river basin transfer of water, and more importantly, enter into meaningful international agreements with Nepal, on which the central government has found itself unable in all these years to have really training of rivers in the upstream. Seventh, I would say that in terms of achievement of human resource development, we have lagged behind on Millennium Development Goals. And what on health outcomes can we do to improve really our acceptance and ability to achieve the challenging Millennium Development Goals? And finally, since we have achieved 11.56% rate of growth in the last 5 years, how does it sustain the same rates of growth for the 12th five-year plan, which is just about to be launched? Namely, how to get on to about 12% rate of growth in the next 5 years to make a deep dent on poverty and further improve the index of human development to sustain our position as perhaps the fastest, if at best the second fastest way.
Thank you very much, NK. Can I now turn to Aranish Singh, who's the executive assistant to Montek from our level?
It's dangerous to ask two people from the Planning Commission to speak. Bihar is a poster boy for the Planning Commission, and I can tell you that. And along with Kushram, it wise for the status of the fastest growing two states in the country as far as the 2004-05 base GDP growth is concerned. Sustaining 11% sustained growth is not a joke. But as Mr. N.K. Singh mentioned, it's largely driven by the public sector or the government intervention. I agree with all the points which the Deputy Chief Minister and Mr. N.K. Singh have raised. If I was to classify and state areas where Bihar has done clearly very well, as indicated by evidence in the form of outcome indicators, these are road connectivity, education attainments and outcomes, and delivery of public health systems, and improvement in law and order. Outstanding performance in 5 to 6 years. A change so quick, which is unparalleled anywhere else in the country. The sectors and areas which in growth policy, which I would say are work in progress, are power, where effects would come to, you know, will be visible in another 4 or 5 years. Large irrigation projects and flood control, where performance is improving because of long gestation, the effects are visible later. And I would say urban infrastructure, where there is thinking that we need to improve. The challenges ahead, I would like to not give too much work to the growth center, but just focus on two very specific areas. I would say these are the opportunities staring at us. Bihar wants to industrialize. The private capital is footloose. It's not visible yet. Whatever investment is coming in is through the Bihari diaspora, home and abroad and elsewhere. A big change is coming on the horizon in the form of opening up of multi-brand retail. And this is going to be conditional on back-end investment in agriculture, logistics. It is a genuine opportunity where Bihar, which has a competitive advantage, can integrate itself with not just national but global supply chains. I'm not advocating a Chibol kind Korean model or an early angel investment, early venture capital kind DMK Tamil Nadu model. But this is clearly a complex intersectoral work. We should be sending out foraging teams to at least tie up with what is on the horizon, like the big global players like Walmart, Tesco, Del Monte, Carrefour. And this will not happen automatically. It's a complex work which has to bring together the industries, the agriculture, and the land revenue department. This is the kind of work where, as Mr. Modi mentioned, about very small farms, lack of economies of scale. This is the kind of work which will need even research, applied work into the kind of tenancy reforms, the kind of changes in the tenancy systems, the kind of relationships which need to bring about with this back-end investment that is going to come in, and the kind of risk sharing and the risk pooling that needs to take place at the farm industry interface level. These are very complex policy interventions, and I don't think the departments in-house have the capability to do it. The Growth Center has financial economists trained at LSE, and I think this is where you should use your skills and work and facilitate this opportunity so that Bihar has the beachhead effect. Bihar is the starter and can take advantage of this opportunity and industrialize. And if possible, the government should act as the angel investor. This is one challenge ahead I wanted to point out. The second challenge, Bihar has achieved at least about 3% plus growth rates compared to the national average. Unfortunately, I mean, this should imply in traditional growth theory that per capita incomes would converge to national average. Unfortunately, because of high fertility rates, the per capita incomes is just creeping like snail, and it is just about one third of the national average. Never before in India, the fertility gaps have been so high that some states are at 1.4, 1.5, and some states, particularly the North Indian large ones, UP and Bihar, at 3.9. If the same one side of argument, one reaction would be, you know, come on, we are a democratic state. We can't do what we did in the 70s. There's another band of literature which says development is the best contraceptive. But it's a very slow contraceptive. But that, if that was allowed to play by itself, Bihar would not reach, let's say, we're talking about Bihar being the developed state by 2015, which by implication implies a conditional convergence in growth theory in terms of per capita incomes. If this was allowed to play by itself, it would be 20 years by the time Bihar would reach half of the national per capita income in India. You would ask me what the answer is. The evidence, the NFHS surveys indicate in traditional societies like Bihar and UP, it is not easy for a woman to look for family planning services. It can be easily done by a focused, improved management model where these services are delivered door to door in rural areas, combined with certain incentive systems. But this is an area of research because there are examples both within the country and around it where, for example, Andhra Pradesh has achieved replacement levels of fertility at lower levels of per capita income, which is beyond what pure development would have allowed it to achieve. Bangladesh, traditional Muslim society, the fertility rates are down to 2.3, reaching replacement levels in 2-3 years. I think the Growth Center should think about this, study these two examples, that how in a democratic framework this has been achieved. The issue now finds its place in the approach to 12th plan as well, which means it has to go into the 12th five-year plan. This is an opportunity, and a brilliant applied research opportunity, where Bihar has the opportunity to be a developed state, if not by 2015, at least by 2020. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, so for the final word, we have Shaibal.
It is very difficult to speak as the last speaker because you don't know what to speak. Most of the points have already been stated here. Now, I would like to mention two things which has not been discussed today. One is that in Bihar, the governance at the provincial level has improved dramatically. But governance needs to be improved at a district or at a lower panchayat level. Especially in the panchayat level, where the money flow is going to be quite substantial in future, I think that needs to be taken care of. Now, the strategy will be top-down or down below. That one has to work out. But I think that has to be taken care of in a very serious manner. Because historically, there has been a governance deficit. Because Bihar being part of an old Bengal presidency, historically, the expenditure on governance was one of the least in the country. That has not improved in the post-independence period. So the institutional memory of governance in Bihar is quite limited. So one has to take that into consideration, that the governance at the panchayat level needs to be improved. And whether there should be a top-down strategy, that has to be worked out, how it should be modeled. And secondly, at the district level, still things needs to be improved. The second point I would like to mention, that while there is a tremendous growth, especially construction-centric growth, but there is need to have some institutional reform in a place like Bihar. I think most of the states of the Indian Union, they had undergone this thing immediately after the election. I'm not talking in terms of only surplus distribution of the land, but there are many other institutional reforms involved in that, especially in the updating of records and various other things. So I think that needs to be taken care of, because if Bihar has to become a developed state by 2015, so these two aspects, governance at a lower level and institutional reform, has to be taken care in a very serious manner. In a serious manner. Thank you.
Two in this report is, first, we try to acquaint ourselves with the objectives and goals of the government, which is through two principal documents, the government's manifesto and the Gazette for Development that they have published with their mission from 2010 to 2015. And then we'll try and identify the principal areas of research, and then we're going to try and match it with the themes that have been stated with the IGC. So it's no original work, it's essentially just identifying research areas. So the report basically looks at certain themes, if you can see. The central block shows you the various zones. So you have the agriculture, rural non-farm industries in the rural areas, and then you have urbanization, which is also a very important theme in Bihar right now. And you have the related problem of migration, which is especially important in Bihar because, interestingly, it's one of the states in India with the highest rate of out-migration. In fact, interestingly, 9% of the state gross domestic product comes from remittances sent by these migrants. So on the top you have state capabilities, which are essential infrastructural components like water resources, which contributes to agriculture, to groundwater management, etc. You have power, which also contributes to agriculture, organization, and you have roads. At the bottom you can see social delivery, service delivery and social inclusion, which includes components such as health, education, government, food security. So now the agenda, which is not for today, this is the agenda of the report, is what are the things we have discussed in the reports. I'm going to go through it very quick. So in agriculture, we've discussed the role of low productivity, which is the role of institutional challenges, minimum support price, credit availability, and diversion of livelihood patterns. Under infrastructure and urbanization, we have discussed a very interesting the concept of decentralized renewable energy and the related concept of husk pass systems, which is new in Bihar and it's been widely recognized worldwide. Also the barefoot solar engineers concept in Rajasthan and the pros and cons of captive power policy, roads, etc. If you're interested, you can have a look at the report. Under natural resources, the important questions are of water resources management, especially groundwater management and irrigation. And under human capital, you have health, education, migration. Health and education have been adequately dealt with already in a way. So under state capabilities, you have rural development, food security, and then you have the question of governance. So what we're going to talk about today is one problem, because we don't have enough time and I'm already speaking really fast. So okay, I'm going to slow down. The laughter indicates that I am indeed speaking very fast. So okay, let's look at food security. So the question is, why are we looking at food security, right? So if you look at it, the government actually in India spends around 80 to 90,000 crores of rupees. Okay, I've not converted it, so 1 rupee is 70 pounds approximately. So you can get an idea. Oh, sorry, the other way around. I'm sorry. Okay. So the government spends it, and food security comes in various forms. Okay. So you have the public distribution system, or the PDS, which is what we're going to discuss. We have the midday meal scheme, which is a scheme that is extended to school children in the form of a midday meal. And you have the supplementary nutritional program for 0 to 3 year olds via the integrated child development scheme. The third one, interestingly, is something where they have to procure the food from the open market. In the first two, the government is providing. Okay, so now let's look at food security. Now, these are two sets of data we're looking at, 2005-2011. If you look at the 2005 block, you can see that there was a survey that was conducted where they tried to identify the diversion rates, right? In which they took two sets of data, which one was the National Sample Survey data and the Food Corporation of India data, which was basically on the expenditure, the consumer expenditure in households, and the Food Corporation of India data was of course on the offtake. And they, based on that, they approximately calculated a sort of offtake diversion rate. If you see here, one of the best performers was Tamil Nadu with a very low diversion rate of 7%. We'll see why they had that later. The national average was 54% and Bihar languished at a 92%. So we have to analyze why that is happening. In 2011, the ratio, there was a different measure of calculation widely deemed to be more accurate. That was the ratio of purchases to entitlement. So clearly the higher it is, the better. So the nationwide average, sample average was 84%. The best performing states were Chhattisgarh and Andhra Pradesh, which had over 90%. And Bihar again was, one of the losers in the race with 45%. So now the thing is, why is it so? Now let's look at the objectives of the Bihar government and what they want to do. And essentially, so as you can see here, their priorities are absolutely, focused right now. So they're saying that we will identify all the BPL families and redress their grievances. We'll provide them with food grains or equivalent cash in its lieu. They'll carry out procurement activities through primary agricultural cooperatives of the state. They'll strengthen the institutions, of course, and of course they're going to develop storage capacity. Now, how do we look at this problem? Let's first identify the main players in this problem, okay? So you have three sets. You have the clients, you have the providers, and you have the state. So who are the clients, okay? Who are the clients in the system? You can have one set where you have only BPL families. You can have another type, BPL is below poverty line. The second set is the below poverty line plus above poverty line families. And the third set could be everyone. You universalize it. Now let's look at the set of players who are the providers. So who's providing? Obviously it's the state, but the state is providing it through some sort of intermediary. So let's identify these intermediaries. So it could be individual suppliers through state instituted fair price shops, which basically have these rationed goods. Or it could be a community-based supply models, which is increasingly gaining prominence, which is the primary agricultural cooperative. Or you could just have private sellers, just get the local grocers, give them the power to sell these sort of rationed goods. Now let's look at the state. Of course, what are the roles of the state? We know it's regulation, it's monitoring and accountability. Of course, the main thing is ensure that the grains actually reach the targeted households, it's not stolen or leaked in the way, and you also ensure that the beneficiaries are correctly identified. So now, let's identify the basic problems of the client. Now, if you look at it, there are three main questions that we can ask. Of course, there are more, which we could discuss later. But first question, and the most important question is, how will the government ensure proper identification of the beneficiaries? So a recent report released by the NC Saxena Committee talks about the fact that, you know, increase the coverage, because if you increase it, it's going to make it better. He recommends a 90% coverage rate. Of course, there's a huge debate going on the viability and the feasibility of universalizing it, but he recommends 90% because the government can afford it. Of course, the NAC brought it down to 75%, but that's another story. Also, the second question is there a reliable way to identify poor households based on proxy indicators? So what are these proxy indicators? So we need to understand that, you know, most of these surveys, the figures that they release are kind of national figures, and national averages are not the correct signals of the local spatial, averages or the spatial values. So you cannot rely on these figures to bring about a one-size-fits-all policy. That's not going to work. Now, the second question we ask is targeting divisive? Now, this is an interesting question because, you know, supposing you're in a village and, you know, your neighbor is getting, food grains, at 35 kgs of food grain at rupees 2 a month, then you have to pay the full price. So you will not be vocal about the problem. You will not, if the fair price shops are not working, if the PDS is not working, then you won't be bothered about it. You'll just say, you know what, go to hell. I mean, I don't care because I'm not getting the benefits of it. So will it prevent the emergence of a united public demand? And we see if we don't have an active citizen group, then most of the schemes don't work in this country. So, you know, the results can be seen in Tamil Nadu, which has universalized it and therefore has been a consistent good performer in both of these sets of data that we've seen. Now, the third question, of course, is in the absence of adequate identification measures, what are the arguments regarding the feasibility of universalizing the PDS. So one of the good performers, that is Chhattisgarh, has actually seen an 80%, has an 80% coverage. So we really need to see what are the pros and cons of universalizing is. The cons, of course, are the huge costs, etc. But there are a lot of positives. Now let's look at the provider set. Of course,
just a minute.
Oh my God. Okay. So let's look at the provider set. So we have three main problems, as you can see. I'm not reading them out. But the main problem is the leakages, right? So how do you solve the problem of leakages? You know, one of the things is in the community-based model is that if you have a community, then you can always ensure accountability. You can ensure that, you know, the way the self-help groups are working for microcredit, you can kind of apply the same logic here. What about private stores? If you have the problem of quality of food grains, then you can use these private stores to, people can use these food coupons to purchase it in any of the stores, and that way you can ensure competition and hence quality. Now this is the state model, Chhattisgarh model. We don't have time to discuss it. Of course, it's a very interesting model. If we had time, we could. And in Bihar, we heard one of the recent reports where the finance minister talked about, emulating the Chhattisgarh model. So will that mean a shift from the system of food coupons? Okay, so basically these are the basic questions, of course. So if you go through the report, you can see a very sectoral pattern, and I hope that's going to facilitate more research for IGC. So this is the main purpose of this, was to give you an overview, an inconclusive overview, of course. But yeah, that's about it. So thank you.
Thank you, Ashani. We're now going to have our four discussants speaking for 5 minutes each. And I very much hope they'll self-monitor so that I don't have to do the unpleasant task of interrupting them. So I'll begin by requesting Professor Prabhat Ghosh.
Thank you. 5 minutes is really tough, Mr. Chairman. Anyway, I try my best. After the presentation is in ODI format, you have the comments in the T20 format. All these studies are in the midway in the career, and they will be again presented in the partner conference in December. So we'll have enough time to comment on that. Right now, I have some friendly advices for all these studies which are midway through. For the first three studies, which talked about health education and health outcomes in the Panchayati Raj, let me remind the scholars that, you see, this is the period from 202 or 203 that you're talking about up to 208 or 210, you know. This is a period in which there have been a number of policy interventions, not a single one of them. And these policy interventions are such that it doesn't have a single focus point. It is bound to have, you know, what they call spread effects or things like that. So when you decide these issues, whether the particular program is having an impact or not, please remember that how much of the outcome, if it is positive, is ascribable to the particular policy issue they're talking about. Give some space for other parallel interventions or, you know, which are almost certain to have some kind of, this is the point one. Second point I want you to remember in mind that when you think of outcomes, you see, certain outcomes are expected to be very short run. One of the interventions that we had in the case of health is that we had the, of course, women empowerment, but simultaneously we had a program called cash incentive for institutional delivery. Now, cash incentive for institutional delivery is an intervention which will have immediate effect. If I do it today, from tomorrow onwards will have effect. So that is one kind of intervention. This is to be contrasted to interventions like improvement in the school building. If we improve in the school building today, which is of course not very difficult or being done, improvement is going to have to be tomorrow. You have to wait for a couple of weeks, you know, couple of years. So remember the distinction between those events in which you are likely to have immediate effects and those interventions you are likely to have, you know, effects with a certain amount of gestation lag, etc. These are about the evaluation. About TOC studies, this is also not, this is actually not an evaluation studies, although an element of an evaluation is there. But it is not evaluation of a program, it is an evaluation of an experiment. You have done the literature, I have also gone through that. It's obvious from the literature that you have varied impacts. The reason is that, you see, if you take this education process of some kind of a production function, now, this, if you introduce capital in the form of computer, you know, it does replace labor. I can understand that, as it does in many other places. But the degree of substitution between capital and labor is much less in activity like education. That's it. That is one difficulty. That is one point we should remember. Second thing, unlike other production functions where the capital is replaced very easily, you know, without any other separate, in this case, the impact of computer-aided learning, CAL, so, is closely conditioned by two other things. The complementary inputs, the hardware, the training, the number of teachers, etc. The complementary inputs are extremely important in such a case like this, where these two inputs will interact with each other. And secondly, again, it's in the literature, you only have to remember it. The ambience does matter extensively. The CA in Kerala and CA in Bihar is not the same thing. You see, kind of infrastructure they have, kind of parental background they have, kind of other consciousness of things are, these two are very different things. So that social ambience has to be kept in mind when you do this analysis. You have already done it. I am just reminding of what you have already written. Unfortunately, if you think of a statistically, you know, or a methodologically, what you need is a some kind of a multivariate model. Unfortunately, in your sample, there are only 14 schools. That makes it difficult, but that doesn't matter. Once you are conscious of this fact, I'm sure very, very important outcomes will come out. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Friends, I will not, because the studies are all work in progress, so I will not tear into the methodology. Dr. Khosh has already dealt with a few things. I just want to make one suggestion.
use of Jharkhand as a control, we need to be very careful. In our academic desperation to look for a counterfactual, Jharkhand has very different socio-economic characteristics compared to Bihar. And tribal areas, the status of women, their traditions are very, very different. So just be careful, that's all. I would like to use my 2-3 minutes for canvassing on behalf of IDC Bihar, where I have been involved with setting it up. And we have the Cabinet Minister for Education here. I don't want to lose the opportunity. And this is on behalf of the presenters. I think the 4 presenters, one issue which came out very starkly here is that we have made a rapid progress in quantity indicators, outcome indicators of education in a relatively small period of time. In the quality indicators, there is much to be done. Bihar has made another big policy leap whereby the control of primary and upper primary education has been handed over on a statutory basis to the panchayats or the Panchayati Raj institutions. It is time that we take the next leap and we consider looking at franchisee models where panchayat is able to give on a franchise to a non-profit education society or private educationist running of these schools on a management basis. And think of a funding pattern where a certain base is given as given, and a part of the funding is linked to attendance of students or their performance in examination or in terms of quality items. And this is just one food for thought I would like to leave with the Education Minister, given the presentations and the theme that has come across. The second issue, a very important regarding the last presentation on identifying issues for research, there was a big focus on public distribution system. There was a study, this has been a cause of worry. The famous Rajiv Gandhi quote comes out of the public distribution system in the late 80s. After the Chief Minister's conference in 2010, expert group or a group was constituted to look at the PDS system. And there are 2 extreme thoughts. One is the PDS, police it well, regulate it better, Chhattisgarh model. The other one is, you know, give cash to the female head of the household and let her decide her own consumption pattern, let the household optimize. The critics say on this side that what you give as cash does not get into the tummy. But the other side says what you're giving through PDS does not get into the tummy anyway. So the third model which is being proposed and is now part of the national report is something called an electronic benefit transfer system, which is linked to this huge biometric UID project being undertaken in India. And this model says that you do not give cash in hand, but you permit the grocery stores to compete with the fair price shops. And it's kind of an electronic food stamp where your entitlement is electronic, but you go with that biometric card. And 50% of your purchase should be from a procurement-linked system whereby farmers have a security of minimum support price. So 50% of, let's say, you buy rice and wheat which comes through the procurement, but the remaining 50% you have a menu of foodstuffs like pulses, oilseed, sugar, among which you can choose. So it gives a quality choice to people. This is the third model which is being talked about. And this is the right stage I thought IGC could do very well by setting up a kind of an experiment, a randomized experiment, where the 3 models and their outcomes could be actually tried out and tested in the field. I've taken my time. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. The next discussion is Pranav Sen.
Thank you. I'll be as brief as I possibly can. Let me begin with the education issue, since it figured in 4 of the presentations. You know, people like me who've been working in this area for a while have found 2 things about Bihar and education which are rather interesting. The first is that Bihar has the historically has had a most peculiar distribution of education attainments of any part of the country. It has the highest rate of it has the highest rate of graduates, and everybody is down there in the middle, very low. Everywhere else in India, it's essentially sort of inverse U-shaped, except in Bihar, it's like that. Now, that's interesting, and it, in a sense, sort of relates to a point that was, I think, made by Nishik about the returns to education. Because the NSS data does provide some information on it, and the interesting thing that came out in Bihar was that there was a huge discontinuity in the increase in returns from the immediate post-primary, where there's a big jump from illiterate. Then there was a discontinuity, and the next jump comes after high school. So the dropout rate in the middle was and has been historically explained by that, and so that needs to be factored in. Now, you know, given this sort of a background of education in Bihar, there are a couple of points I'd like to make. The first is on Chiroshree's paper and the fact that with the introduction of computer-assisted learning, what is essentially a unimodal distribution is becoming bimodal. Now, this is something which is, number one, interesting, number two, potentially very dangerous, which means that the way you actually set up the research really needs to go beyond looking at the effectiveness of CAM. You need to really look at, is it actually causing more damage than can be sort of tolerated in the system. The second point is on the issue of learning outcomes. You know, one of the things that's been happening in India, and I don't know the facts about Bihar, unfortunately, is that there have been changes being made in the syllabus, particularly in the school syllabus, very often. So quite often what happens is that when you're comparing against, you know, across time, so 2000, 2007, you don't know whether a syllabus change has happened in the middle. Well, I don't know. But if it has, it actually jeopardizes all your comparisons. So one has to be a little careful on that. The other thing which I found very, totally interesting was that in the paper by Priyaranjan, it turned out that the outcome, learning outcomes, were worse for the Indian languages, which were Hindi, Urdu, and Sanskrit, as against English. Now, we've been told repeatedly that all education should, in fact, be in the mother tongue. That data suggests that that's wrong. The kids want to learn English. They don't really care about Hindi or Urdu or Sanskrit at all. Now, if that's the case, I think it's a research issue on its own. And this is a research issue in terms of motivations for education. Now on the Santosh, the study that you're doing on health, you know, it's, I find it a little peculiar that you're asking a very specific question, which is what does reservation for women in the political system due to health outcomes. I mean, if you're looking at the health outcomes data anyway, and you're actually starting to control for a whole range of things, why don't you just make it a study of health outcomes in Bihar and the causal factors, of which you can study women's health outcome, women's reservation as one of the factors you're looking at. Finally, on the development priorities, for Bihar, I think it's a fairly comprehensive list that IGC is looking at. But I do notice one rather important omission, which is I don't see industrialization anywhere there. Is it that the government of Bihar has decided that industrialization is not in their priority list? Which would mean that it's a very, very strange development strategy that the Bihar government is going with. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Our final discussant is Chinmay Kumar.
Thank you. Just a few quick comments. I mean, it's a lot of things that I was going to talk about has already come up, so I'm not going to repeat that. So basically, one comment on Santosh's presentation of women reservations. So again, like Mr. Pranav Sen said, that even I found it really puzzling that, that it's so specific, especially because I don't really, I mean, we need to, it has larger implications the way we frame questions, research question, especially in the area of development. Often, we don't have good theoretical understanding of what is going on. So women reservation, what does it lead to and how? So I mean, we need to understand that. And the second part, the health outcomes. What are the determinants of health outcomes? I mean, what are the different causal mechanisms that influence the channels through which women reservation can have an impact on health outcome? I try to think of ways through which, but I couldn't really come up with anything, especially if you're interested in health outcomes. So one could look at the process indicators, whether there's a shift towards that, but outcomes are determined by so many factors. I mean, identifying a mechanism through which it affects outcome would be very different, would be very difficult. So as Mr. Pranav Sen suggested that, yeah, you could perhaps, I mean, either there are two distinct questions here. One is to look at the impact of women's reservation, and then you could look at the broad range of indicators rather than just the health outcomes, or other you just look at the health outcomes and determinants of health outcome. So these are two distinct questions, and it seems that you have clubbed it together without really that doesn't really make sense, especially to me. So that's but it's a preliminary stage, so definitely you can work on it. So, and second is another general comment. So like when we do impact evaluation, like the cycling to school scheme and also, it's always like what impact a particular program has had, but why does it work or why it doesn't work? I mean, why question often misses out in most of these studies. So, and that's like it's not easy to actually answer it, and we need to go beyond the current methodological regime that we have and maybe complement our study with qualitative studies as well, that why has certain schemes work, why other others don't work. So just, yeah, a couple of things.
We'll be breaking for now, and we'll be resuming at 3:50, so we have about a 20-minute break.
Should,
instead of having, you know, posters for films, they have posters for computer courses, management courses. I mean, there's just a palpable demand for particularly higher education in the state. Now, talking to people with a long memory like Anjan, there was a time when Bihar was a center for education. So I guess my first question is there a set of things that the government of Bihar could do to make the state more, to return it to become more of a center for, I'm not talking about primary education, I'm talking about vocational education, higher education. And that's all, that point is also made by the observation that when you go outside Bihar, an awful lot of educated people are from Bihar. You know, so if you look at the classes in the top management schools, chemists, doctors, and so forth, an awful lot of those people are Bihari. They may not be working in Bihar. So I think there has to be something about how do you think about it. The role of education, higher education, vocational education in Bihar, because that's obviously a dramatic way of introducing productivity improvements into the state. And the second thing is very clearly, you're not going to have big increases in productivity unless you do have industrialization. All the macro data suggests that roughly agricultural production keeps up with population, so per capita is roughly flat in the 60s. And you have a bit of take off in manufacturing, and you have a take off in services, and the
the manufacturing sort of comes around the mid-70s and serves a bit later, and now serves as a big driver in the whole of India. So I guess I'd like to hear a little bit from the panel, what are the concrete things? And by concrete things, I mean which sectors would they think are viable propositions for cities in Bihar, or never mind cities, for Bihar? And what measures, again, could be used to encourage such whether it's service sector, manufacturing, to come to Bihar? Because I think you can say, well, we want this and this by 2015, but without fairly radical shape up in how you think about development, moving essentially from a rural-based model to something which is much more about structural change and urbanization, not viewing those as positives, it's going to have to be where you go, because at the moment, those people who are shifting their perspective often shift into urban sectors that are not within Bihar. So I thought I'd just open that out to the panel, and then we can bring in your comments. So anybody who would like to, yes.
Robin, you may be aware that when you are faced with an economic scenario of a state like Bihar, at that point, it's only the state intervention. The investment comes only through public investment. You can't expect private players to come at that stage. We, in 2005, when the present government took over, the conditions were not such that anybody could have ever conceived of making a single penny's investment in Bihar. It takes time. You have to provide a platform, and then only you can expect private investment to flow in. So far, government is concerned, it has its limitations. Now, I have been advocating, in fact, I have been speaking in all my public meetings, asking and requesting people of Bihar that they should set the pace of investment, and then only we can expect outside investment to pour in. I have been requesting people that you set up institutions of teachers training, you set up medical colleges, you create institutions of management and higher education and not like that. Unfortunately, the response is not very encouraging, or rather, it is not as fast as we would require. However, some people have been evincing interest in setting up medical colleges and other institutions of higher learning, higher education. So perhaps we have, in last 6.5 years, we have not reached the stage where we can expect a big private intervention and participation. They would be asking for better quality of roads, power, as has been mentioned. Everybody knows that we are facing acute power problem. Then some more facilities. There is little amount of regional imbalance in Bihar. Various districts are not yet developed. They don't provide quality school education. Now, anybody who would be making investment in those districts and living there, he would certainly like that his children have facilities in that district. So that kind of infrastructure needs to be developed before we can invest private investment to come in. So far government is concerned, government is indeed endeavoring. Last couple of years, we have set up a national standard law school. We have set up a management institution. We have collaborated with National Institute of Fashion Design to set up their institution. Institutions are coming, but actually
we had expected faster entry, which is not.
Regarding the second question raised about the industrialization or manufacturing, so private investment has started flowing in Bihar. It is not that the private investment is not coming. Recently, in two big projects of roads and bridges, more than 800 crore is going to be invested in a big bridge in Bihar. In another road project also in public private partnership. So the private investment started coming, but in the manufacturing sector, it is more or less the agro-based industries. In the last 6 or 8 months, more than 4 biscuit factories of Britannia, Parle, the known biscuit companies of India, they have started their production in Bihar. Then because of this cycle scheme, free distribution of bicycle, all the top bicycle companies, Hero and all other companies, they are going in for Bihar. Recently, about 7 days back, I was in France, I was in Paris. I met a delegation of Indian delegation. They were in France, Apparel Export Corporation of India. And they were telling that more than 80,000 crore of export is taking place in India of only garments. And the major sector, then the major manufacturing places are Tripur or Mumbai and Faridabad. And those businessmen, they were telling that more than 30% of the labor force is from Bihar. And they have come to Bihar and they've opened 6 training centers for the apparel manufacturing. And they were discussing with me, in the coming few years, if Bihar government take initiatives, Bihar can become a big hub of manufacturing of the apparel garments, of the apparel. So in this way, the investment has started coming. People are taking interest. But the biggest roadblock is the land. Because as of all, you all of know, there is a problem of land. And recently, the government of India has introduced a bill of land acquisition. And Bihar, because it is a fertile land, so land is the big is the biggest obstacle for installation. So regarding this second question, I think that it will take some more time, but the investment has started flowing in Bihar.
Thank you very much.
Okay. Yeah, I think, I agree with the observations which have been made both by Mr. Shahi and Mr. Modi. In response to the first issue which you raised on the fact that instead of the posters of Aishwarya Rai, the posters of computer training are all over rural Bihar. I mean, in a certain sense, that's a very healthy sign because, I think that the fact that it's beginning to focus on where the future of the young Biharis lie, not in emulating really the Aishwarya Rai's of the world. Although, by the way, Bihar is one of the states where there is a very viable National Institute of Fashion Technology, which has begun to take ground. But I think that I have a slight variant on what Mr. Shahi said. The fact remains that on vocational education, in spite of a rather attractive a package which was announced by the finance minister, private investment in vocational education linked by for not only upgrading existing ITIs, but linked by industry groups has not yet taken off the ground to be able to, let us say, train 1.5 million Biharis all over. Mr. Modi is so right that in regard to Tirupur, let me give you another example that when I visited the Jamnagar plant in which is in Gujarat, Mr. Ambani told me that currently, since it's being expanded, there are roughly about 40,000 workers which are working. About 70% of them are from Bihar. He therefore was suggesting that I have to invest a hell of a lot of money in training these people and in bringing them up to standards. If you could set up and link up with large industrialization taking place elsewhere in terms of plan and having vocational training which matches the emerging demand, I think that would make a very, very important contribution. If you, for instance, say which are the large 10 big investments taking place, what kind of skills they would require, and the vocational training institutions are then linked to the emerging demand for those kind of skills and really getting private investment into it. So that's one thing. On industrialization, I entirely agree that clearly comparative factor advantages and in terms of the opportunity cost of investment, which would be there, the Bihar's comparative factor advantage lies in terms of the not only agro-based, but the variant of that would be, of course, things like fisheries, dairy, a whole range of other stuff. A lot of the industrialization of rural France is taking place on only agro and agro-based. Bihar has the kind of conditions to be able to have the comparative factor advantage in those kind. I mean, one of the happy things that Mr. Modi knows about is that Nestle is wanting to have a deep footprint in Bihar's dairy industry, which is a good sign that they are beginning to look up. They have sent two teams already, begun to identify sites. So Del Monte is looking very seriously at a particular point in North Bihar, in Kishanganj, to be able to make that into a hub for pineapple. Similarly, there are other kinds of things, looking at things like lychees and so on. So I think that the comparative factor advantage of Bihar must be really exploited. How does it go about it? One clearly is that the marketing of Bihar in terms of opportunity, that's something on which we need to improve upon. The fact that for the reasons that Mr. Shahi mentioned, Mr. Modi mentioned, the enabling environment for investment has dramatically altered, both in better quality of infrastructure and in terms of the overall environment of security. I think that Bihar needs more aggressive marketing on its investment opportunities than has been possible so far. Also, I think in terms of second, the enabling fiscal regime to attract private investment, to overcome some of the risk bottlenecks which historically Bihar may have had embedded in people's psyche. We have a reasonably friendly policy. Now, for the reasons that Mr. Modi was mentioning, that at long last, Government of India has realized that Bihar does need some little help on an enabling fiscal regime. There's a group which is going to the Planning Commission to look into Bihar's case for a special category state. More than the issue of the percentage of devolution which should be grants versus loan, is going to look into the case of Bihar's case for giving excise break, income tax break, corporate tax break, which will be on the footing of the 12 states to improve the fiscal regime for getting private investment into it. I think that the availability of land is a very major issue. But I think that as jobs are created outside agriculture, that's the time. And by the way, the idea of a missing middle and creating a manufacturing hub is a more generic issue for the country as a whole. But for the case of Bihar also, land will become available if alternative employment avenues outside agriculture begin to get generated. And finally, I think that you did ask Robin the question that in the services sector, I think that Bihar has a huge, huge opportunity in the service sector. We have the talent in terms of human resource development. To give you just one example, the United States is currently looking at wanting 1 million nurses being trained every year for meeting the requirement of paramedics. And they have completely exhausted what they can get from Philippines and some of the other countries. These are areas in the service sector which needs financial services, outsourcing. We need to look at the whole area of the services sector, but given the fact that we have a competent, skilled, trained human resource, we can make use of that in a credible way. But we need to do a couple of things which I mentioned.
Okay, we have time for one more question. Yes, sir.
Thank you.
have about 10 more minutes. I think, not to deprive you of... That's fine. So after Mr. Shahi's done that, I'd like to open it to the floor so that we can maybe collate a few questions. I guess, have we missed something? Are there other areas that we should be focusing on? And we'll close the session at 5 o'clock. So you'd like to...
Mr. Singh has just now raised the issue of vocational education, and particularly government not trying to do much in attracting industries to train, to provide trade skilled workforce. I am only trying to update that Bihar has taken very strong initiative. It has established its own open schooling system, Bihar Board of Open Schooling Examination, and we had several rounds of discussion in Delhi with National Skill Development Council. Ms. Subbaiya, who is chairman of the corporation, he himself went and had very good interaction with the Chief Minister before a full team of officials, and we are already in the process of tying up with several sector skill councils. In fact, on last Friday, Government of India has finalized the draft of National Vocational Education Quality Framework. I was chairing that. So we have taken very positive steps to ensure that the fruits of vocational education in terms of training and providing a skilled labor which remains in unorganized sector and which is being exploited because of not being certified for a particular skill. We are very hopeful that in the next couple of years we would be in a very, very positive state to carry out our programs in that area.
Okay, thank you very much. So questions? Okay, so we see one in the middle here, a couple there, a little above. Let's get sort of 3-4 questions. So one.
Hi, my name is Vijendra Rao from the Research Department of the World Bank. So my question really is, I've been visiting Bihar now for about 4 years, working in panchayats and now with the Jivika project, livelihoods project. And one thing that strikes me is that in the first sort of 2 or 3 years that I've been watching things, things were proceeding extremely optimally. And there was a huge opportunity that was needed to be fulfilled and that was going on. But after the election, after the last election, what I'm finding is that there's a great pressure to do more. And that may be stretching the resources of implementation. So the question I have is, I'm sure the government is aware of the problem, but is that a strategy that you have that let's go all out, push all we can, regardless of what, and see what we can achieve? Or is there an idea that we should be doing this optimally and not overstretching resources of implementation agencies?
Okay, gentleman down here.
Yeah, thank you. I'm Malik Fida Abdullah Khan from Bangladesh. I'm working in the water and climate for more than 20 years. I just, in response to the Deputy Chief Minister that he mentioned that about the flood problem is one of the major challenges out of six. In Bangladesh, we have a lot of action research that carried out and also involving the community, the people for the dissemination of the flood information. So it's my suggestion, it's not a question, it's my suggestion that in collaboration with the Bangladesh experience, Bihar can also take place their research work in the flood management. So this is my suggestion. Thank you.
Thank you. There's a lady.
My name is Aditi Padnis. I'm political editor with the Business Standard newspaper in India. I am not originally a native of Bihar, but it's my the second most favorite place on earth. But it is intensely frustrating and intensely annoying sometimes. Why does Bihar not fix its tourism? There are repeated complaints from my friends from Sri Lanka, friends from Japan, that it is a huge ordeal to visit those places. Why doesn't anyone do fix that? The roads are lousy, there's no physical infrastructure to stay, they are fleeced all the time, there are middlemen, contractors, and it's just awful. Secondly, I find that nobody at all is talking about the elephant in the room, which is land reform. The government told us that it would go ahead with land reform, a committee was made, the committee submitted its report, and that's the last we heard of it. There is absolutely no forward movement on that. If there is no land, then there's no point in talking about land reform. If you're going to do land reform, why not use the surplus land for everybody's benefit? Thirdly, I totally agree with Dr. Gupta that the lower bureaucracy and the lower judiciary in Bihar has to be fixed on an urgent basis. The functioning is still very erratic and very feudal, and it's caste and cronyism which rules. Thank you.
Okay, so final question from Anja.
Further up.
One more question.
He's the first hand. The person there is the first hand.
Well, my name is Hardik Shah. I'm from Government of Gujarat. I have one compliment, one suggestion, and a comment. Maybe a question I can say. Compliment is. Bihar is really developing very well, and it can be evinced from the cries of Gujarati entrepreneurs, especially the construction and infrastructure people in Gujarat who are crying these days, saying that they don't get unskilled labors which they used to get from Bihar, because a lot of construction, and especially in the road and other sectors, which is already going on in Bihar. So that's the compliment. The suggestion is taking a clue from what Honorable Deputy CM said, that Bihar is thinking to create a skilled migrant people, workforce, which can bring some revenues in Bihar back to home. Maybe for that matter, the model that Gujarat has adopted, taking the industries into the loop, what is the demand of industries, and we can work it out. Maybe Tata's, Birla's, Ambani's, or even Infosys, having talked to them, what is their requirement, and Bihar can look into that particular aspect to create a very specific type of skill pool. The last is a question, why are in Bihar thinking of creating the migrant skill pool? Instead of that, why can't we think of retaining those skilled people within Bihar and using their skills in harnessing the resources and the strength that Bihar has for ensuring the agenda of Bihar's growth and development getting fulfilled by 2015 or 20? Thank you.
Okay, I think I have to draw the questions to a close. And I think actually, in the interest of time, what I suggested, panelists, those that want to, can just give me 1 minute to be listening to all this stuff. Your sort of final word, starting with Arunesh and coming down this way.
I give it to Mr. Modi, because he can answer the question.
Let's, I think if the panelists, if you'd like to say anything.
You want to say anything?
You don't have to.
You have to.
I welcome most of the suggestions. And regarding land reforms, that is a big political issue. And no government would like to, its survival. So the land reform is a big issue. So the time is very less, and it is not possible to answer all the suggestions which has come here. But we will take notice of all the suggestions which have been given by the different members here.
Just very quickly, yes, I think that tourism has a huge prospect, and I myself was a little embarrassed that I didn't mention that. not as a challenge, and as a, it's a challenge, but it's also a huge opportunity. And I think we need to do something on that. And I think that on this first question, that are we pushing the button on resource far beyond what implementation can support? I think given urgency, we would have to push the button and also push for improved implementation, because we cannot slacken in terms of the pace of growth. And I think that on the last suggestion of retaining skilled labor in Bihar, well, that's exactly what we are trying to do, that we retain them in Bihar. And certainly, if they have to go out, we don't want to interfere with market forces. We certainly allow market forces to operate, but to try and retain them in Bihar, which is what the effort at value-added migration is all about. The word managed migration is an area where I think that the whole effort is to move towards high value-added migration if they have to go out and search a better life quality. But the new economic opportunities in Bihar will really enable them to work in Bihar and seek gainful opportunities than seek mechanical jobs elsewhere.
I'm really thankful to Mrs. Fadnis that she has chosen Bihar as a second destination. I don't know which is the first destination. I would only like to clarify land reform. She talked about committee's report. She knows that before becoming minister, I was Advocate General for the state of Bihar, and I had the opportunity of reading each sentence of the report submitted by Mr. Bandopadhyay. With greatest respect to Mr. Bandopadhyay, I can only say that I don't know what kind of report he has prepared, which created a lot of, undefined or provocation to civil unrest. Even though if you go through the report, you will find nothing worth implementation. It's kind of report. I have read it very minutely. And whatever suggestions he made in respect of tenancy, sharing of that, those laws already exist. No new laws are to be made. And rest of it, I don't know. If we were to carry out the recommendations made by Mr. Bandopadhyay, the entire state will be witnessing bloodshed and all kind of things without anything concrete of some value addition being there. So I wanted to clarify that.
I just want to make two quick points. One regarding lower bureaucracy, and I think yes, it's very important. It's our responsibility, and we haven't done as well as many other states in developing second rung and third rung bureaucracy. And regarding land reforms, already mentioned, but one thing which we need to do is at least our land records need to be updated on a priority basis.
I'd like to close the session and to thank our panelists for a fascinating set of topics, which we hopefully can take forward in some areas with the help of the IGC, and particularly the IGC offices in Parliament. Thank you very much.